clean and bright. You look happy to meet me. Blossom of snow, may you bloom and grow. Bloom and grow forever. Edelweiss, bless my homeland of snow. May you bloom and grow, bloom and grow forever. Every morning, Edelweiss, Edelweiss, small and white, my homeland forever. You look happy to me. Blossom of snow, may bloom and grow, and grow forever. Small as white, clean and bright, you look happy to meet me. Blossom of snow, may and grow, Edelweiss, and grow forever. Every morning, Edelweiss, small and white, clean and bright. You look happy to meet me. Blossom of snow, may you bloom and grow, bloom and grow forever. Edelweiss, Edelweiss, bless my homeland forever. Happy to meet me. Blossom of snow, may you bloom and grow, bloom and and grow forever. Edelweiss, Edelweiss, bless my homeland forever. Happy to meet me, blossom of snow, may you bloom and grow, bloom and grow forever. Edelweiss, Edelweiss, bless my homeland for. Happy to meet me, blossom of snow, may you bloom and grow, bloom and grow forever. Edelweiss, Edelweiss, bless my homeland forever. Edelweiss, Edelweiss, every morning you greet me, small and white, clean and bright. Happy to meet me, blossom of snow, may you bloom and grow, bloom and grow forever. Edelweiss, Edelweiss, bless my homeland for. Thank you.
Well, we'll get started here. Quick introduction. My name is Tom, and I get to serve as one of the pastors here at the Pursuit Church. And it's an honor to host this service today. Deb has been a part of this local church for many years, and a huge part of our kids' ministry. And as someone who has kids in our kids' department right now, I've been a recipient of just her incredible love and care for the people in this church. And so it's truly an honor to be able to host this service today. And I just want to say welcome to everyone who's here in attendance, all the family who are here local but traveled from far, and all the friends as well who took time to come and celebrate and honor Deb's life. And I just hope that that God ministers to you today, that he meets you in the middle of whatever you're feeling today, whether it's grief, whether it's sadness, whether there's anger, whether there's big questions, whatever it is, that God's big enough to meet you in the middle of it. But what I want to do before we really get started is begin this time with a word of prayer, and then we'll jump into a time of singing together. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we come to you today. I'm thankful for the hope of heaven. God, we believe in faith that Deb is with you now, that as a woman who put her trust and faith in you, that she is with you, smiling and enjoying the everlasting peace and joy that comes from a relationship with you. But God, I pray that this service, you'd be glorified, and that Deb would be honored, that the stories shared, the scriptures spoken, the song sung would be medicine to our hurting souls, but also would be a fitting tribute to this incredible woman that many of us know well in this room today. So we dedicate this time to you, and we ask that you would move in power in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to sing a song together. I invite you to stand and sing with us, and Stephanie will lead us.
Alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still. When striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on the cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied for every sin. Laid here in the death of Christ, I live. There in the ground, his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry till final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
And now this time I want to invite Brittany Bush, who is our Kids Pursuit Director, to come and share and read the history, the obituary for Deb.
You can be seated. My name's Brittany, and I had the immense pleasure of getting to serve with Deb here Sunday mornings, and her coming in with her baseball cap, and she was a rule follower and always loving on the kids, but she had her rules set in place, and we had a meeting a few months ago, and Deb just surprised me with a story. I don't know if you know where our church history is, but we were downtown in a building. It was I don't know if you've seen the billboards. They said new church, old strip club. And Deb, we were all sharing how long we have been going to the church, and Deb said, "Well, I was in that building long before you guys were there." But she said, "I only worked there for a day." Then she went downstairs and found out what the building was there. And I just, Deb being so serious, for her to just to share that, it stopped me in my tracks in the meeting, and I couldn't go on anymore and just kept looking at her. So to all of her family and friends who knew her, this is just an honor to be here with you and to share this. So thank you. Debra Jean Mitchell was born April 4th, 1955, the daughter of Ernest and Leah Alhard Mitchell in Jamestown, North Dakota. She graduated from Jamestown High School and then attended Mayville State University. Debra was blessed with three daughters, Natasha, Chelsea, and Mackenzie. She also had two grandchildren, Kaya and Lindley. She truly cherished being their grandmother and spending time with them. She was a member of First Lutheran Church for many years, where all three of her daughters were baptized. Later in life, she began attending the Pursuit, where she volunteered in the nursery until her time of death. Debra loved camping with her daughters and grandchildren. She loved making and purchasing crafts, especially snowmen. Having her family over to decorate and celebrate the holidays provided great joy for her. She was a great lover of babies and toddlers and ran a daycare for a short time before she was diagnosed with cancer a second time. After beating cancer the second time, she was deemed the miracle patient by her doctor and nurses. Throughout Deb's life, her faith was a central part of who she was. She knew that no matter what obstacle life gave her, God would see her through. Her loving family includes her children, Natasha, Nick Hollinger, Chelsea, Gabe Markle, Duncan, Mackenzie Duncan, two grandchildren, Kaya and Lindley, Patrice Mitchell, her sisters, Barb Jorn, Richard, Kim Mitchell, and Nancy, Jeff Beck, and numerous nieces and nephews and cousins. She was preceded in death by her parents, Leah and Ernest Mitchell, and various loved aunts and uncles.
Thank you, Brittany. One of the things that, as we met to plan for the service, the family really wanted to have a time of sharing. And so what we're going to do now is I'm going to invite Barb Bjorn Deb's sister to come up and share a few words. But after she's finished sharing, if anybody would like to come up and share as well, feel the freedom to do so. We have some stairs over here. Be careful as you come on up. Obviously, you know, not everybody in the room can share today, but if there's a few people who really just on their heart would love to say a few words about Deb, come on up and we'll share the microphone with you. But Barb, do you mind coming on up and sharing?
My name is Barb, and I'm one of Deb's three sisters. This is my grandson, Josiah, who's in charge of keeping me together up here. So my favorite memory of Deb in general will be that of meeting her in Bismarck and spending the weekend in a hotel. At first, it was us bringing our kids. Eventually, it was us bringing our grandkids. We always had a grand old time. She was my sister, a best friend, and a confidant. We talked for hours of if either of us were going through the most difficult times in our lives. I will truly miss that. We shared a room when growing up, once a plane crashed near our house. It was a 10 p.m. flight, so after that, she made me stay awake for over a year until that plane passed over safely. I lost a lot of hours sleep. I bet she's laughing about that now. She loved her kids, grandkids, family, and friend. My heart goes out to everyone grieving, especially to Tasha, Chelsea, McKenzie, Kaya, and Lindley. I know you know how important you were in her lives. When Deb had to shave her head because she had cancer, I offered to shave mine also. I would have done it, of course, but to be honest, I was a little relieved when she refused to let me do it. The funniest moment I ever shared with Deb was after a bit of a heated discussion between Deb and a clerk at Hobby Lobby, who got in the car afterwards, and she looked at me and honestly said, "I'm discovering that sometimes I'm not a people person." I looked at her and said, "Discovering just now? Really?" Okay. We started laughing and laughed to the point where we were crying. It took us about 5 minutes to get out of the parking lot. Deb has always had a very strong faith and was devoted to God. When she found out she had cancer, I drove to Minot to be with her. We were sitting on our back steps, hugging and crying, and I asked if she was scared. She said, "No, I will not let those thoughts live in my mind. When it starts, I say a prayer, do my devotions, recite Bible verses, just good stuff. I know God has made promises of miracles to me, and I am claiming them. I want him to cure me, and I believe he will." And God did give her a miracle, not once, but twice, after cancer returned a few years later. Her faith inspired me to depend upon God more deeply, and for that, I am eternally grateful. Eternally grateful, get it? Anyway, my son Tanner, jokingly and in admiration of Debbie, always says he's not the Christian that Debbie is, so he prays to her because she's got connections. One of the hardest things God will ever ask us to do is to give a loved one back. This is so very hard, but he offers comfort with all of our memories and the fact that we know she was doing better than anybody she's left behind. I, as well as many of you in the church, love and cared about Debbie. Some of our lives have changed forever, but so has Debbie's. So let's celebrate that.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing, Barb. If anybody else would like to come and say a few words, feel free to come up at this time.
I love microphones, by the way. First, I want to start out with two stories about Debbie, my favorite stories. The first one was her and I were going on a swim team, a meet, and I think McKenzie or somebody was swimming, and we're driving along, and I kept saying, "Is it icy out or not?" because it was supposed to be stormy. She kept saying, I don't know. And we kept talking for like 10 miles. I wish they would do something so we could see the icy, and she goes, "Stop the car, I'll get out." She stopped the car, and she opened up the door, and whoosh. I mean, she's gone. And I'm like, oh my gosh. And she gets up and she goes, it's icy. She goes, we got to turn around. And the second story I need to tell you is we were at Christmas one time and we had finished it opening up the gifts and we were kind of cleaning up and people were throwing away the packages and stuff. And she said to Tasha and Chelsea, hurry up and pick up your stuff before somebody steals it. And Barb said, who in our family do you think steals? And she goes, I don't know, but we teased her for years about it. There are three things that I really respect about Deb. One is her hats, and we both loved hats. She liked it because she didn't have a lot of hair, and I liked it because I didn't like to do my hair, but we loved wearing hats. The second thing I respected for her was her bravery. She raised three kids by herself and did a great job. And the other thing was her bravery through cancer. And she always said, I don't ask. I don't want to know what stage I have. I don't want to know any of that. Just do what they need to do and get it out of me. And so I really appreciated that. And the third thing that I really respected her was for her love of her family. And she loved you guys and the son-in-laws too. She talked about you all the time. And she was very proud of all of you. Okay. My sister Deb and I always didn't have a kumbaya relationship. And if you know the Mitchell sisters, that's just part of who we are. And Chelsea said to me during this week, I had to take a break. And I said, well, I'm glad we passed that legacy on to you guys because it should go on. But I always loved Deb and she always loved me and I always knew that. And I thank God for letting her be in my life.
My mom was an amazingly strong human. Life wasn't always easy on her, but that never stopped her from believing God would get her through it. I wasn't always the easiest child to raise, but she never gave up on me and always supported me. Whenever I'm having a crappy day or just can't seem to relax, I would call her and instantly... instantly feel relief. Just hearing her voice would put me at ease. I'm not sure how to do life without her. I wanted her to be there for so many more milestones I have yet to come. I know she will be watching over all of us, but it's just not the same. If there is one thing she passed down to all three of us, it was her strength, which we are all going to need right now. I am forever grateful for the times we got to share. Every time I watch Gilmore Girls, I know she will be watching it with me. I will love and miss her always.
Is there anyone else who would like to say a few? Oh, here we go.
So I don't really have many words to say so much as the story. We talked a lot about my mom's faith and how central it was to her life. And I remember one time, Chelsea and I we'd always go to North Dakota for the summers when we lived in Spokane, and we were driving back, and we went into a store, and we came back out, and we had a flat tire. And my mom started crying, because, you know, that was before cell phones. We're in the middle of nowhere. She knows nobody in this town, and just trying to figure out what to do. And she just started praying. And I remember Chelsea and I being scared, and she's like, God has got us. And she sat there and she prayed, and pretty soon a man just came to our window and offered to help us. And he fixed our tire, and we were on our way, and just, she always had a strong faith in God.
need a little extra support. There was just one story I wanted to say. When we first moved into our house in North Dakota, Kenzie was a baby, and she was in her crib, and it was the morning time, and Mom came and woke me up. She's like, there's a bat in the house, there's a bat. And I'm like, well, what do you want me to do? So then I was helping her like swat it, and then it went into Mackenzie's room, and we shut the door, and she's like, it's got Kenzie, it's got Kenzie. I'm like, God. But yeah, so that was just a funny story, and that's all I kind of wanted to share, but I'm just gonna miss her a lot. So I thank her for not giving up on us kids and just being there for us always. So that's that. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Okay, I know the betting's starting. How much is it going for now? Because they all know I cry. Our family started out with a strong German grandmother, but she raised her children by herself. She had strong faith. One time I stayed with her, and she had her laundry done, dried on the clothesline, and done by 8 o'clock when I got up. That woman raised my aunts, uncles, and my mother, and she did a job of, you work hard, you have strong faith, and you keep going. None of this entitlement. It was up to you. My mom and dad raised us very much the same as my cousins were raised, in a family that got up and went to church on Sunday together, and all of my sisters and my brothers and my nieces and nephews are doing the same thing. One of my favorite stories about Debbie is her kids were not behaving and they were begging for stuff. And so she said, they're always telling me that I'm mean, so I'm going to prove to them what a mean mother is. And she said, you think I'm a mean mother? All right. So she said, I stopped at a gas station, I bought a candy bar, and I got in the car, and I started eating it. And Chelsea's, I smell a candy bar. And so they go, you have a candy bar? And she goes, yeah. They go, well, where's ours? Mean mothers don't give their children candy bars. So she said, I then drove and I got into the house and the kids are coming out and there was a dog there and it was kind of a vicious dog. And the kids are going, Mom, Mom, there's a dog. And she goes, mean mothers don't help their children. And she goes, oh my, I felt bad. She goes, I felt really bad. And she goes, I'm watching them out the window and they make it in. And all of a sudden she goes, do you get the point? You're not a mean mom, you're a really good mom. So the one thing that, of course, I'm grateful for Debbie is, and all my sisters and brothers, they've shared their children with me. They've never said, I'm their mother, I'm their father. They've never said, those are my grandchildren. But let me tell you, I respect who their parents are and how they've raised them. And for that, for Debbie, thank you for giving me children. Also, thank you for everyone that brought bars and who has been here for our family. I know that we totally would like to say thank you to every one of you because you have help the day go far, or the week go better. God bless.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for those who shared. So many great memories, so many great stories were shared. And so we're going to sing another song here together. So I invite you to stand up with us and let's sing.
It's like a river attendeth my way. When sorrows like sea billows roll, what
may be seated. Again, thank you so much for those who came up here and shared stories, and it was just a treat to hear those awesome memories. And as I've spent some time with the family, it's been really neat to get to know Deb through them. I knew Deb from church, and we had occasional conversations, but I didn't get to know her quite like many of you knew Deb. And I was thinking about some of the things I've heard about her and some of the things that stood out to Deb, and it's already been reiterated, but I want to point them out here. Is there's three big things that stood out to me about Deb as I've got to get to know her through the family. Is number one, there is no doubt about it, she loved her family deeply. She loved her kids, and especially loved her grandkids, and I know she loved making memories, and that was important to her. And the daughter shared with me that she loved having the family over for holiday get-togethers and decorating the house. And I also learned how particular she was about the decorations. And you could set them up, and then she'd come right behind you and then set them up how she wanted to have them set up. But she loved just having the family over together. Another thing that was so evident as I've got to know Deb, and of course we experienced it here at the church, but her faith was central to her life. She loved Jesus deeply. And her faith was the thing that guided her through all of life's ups and downs. And her kids described her in some terms like this, but as a persistent evangelist. you know, always tell them that you need Jesus, right? Telling them about Jesus. And she's right. Y'all need Jesus. I'm a pastor, so I'm going to reiterate it. Every one of you, you need Jesus. And number three, I love this about Debbie, but she was adventurous. Loved camping and being outdoors. And the story that just I got a kick out of is they were on a houseboat. The family was on a houseboat, and people were jumping off the roof, and it was 20 feet or so to the water. And she surprised everyone, climbed up to the top, and jumped off and just made a big splash. And just, I love that. I love learning that about her. And when I met with Tasha, Chelsea, Mackenzie, and Nick, I asked them basically an impossible question, which was, if you could describe Debbie in one word, what would it be? And here's what I got from them. There's three words: strong, stubborn, and supportive. Does that sound like Debbie right there? Strong, stubborn, and supportive. Strong because of her ability to persist and overcome no matter what life threw at her. She beat cancer not once, but twice. She was dubbed the miracle patient. She was a single mom who raised three easy kids, I've heard, really easy kids. But with God's strength, she was able to navigate it all. Stubborn, I was told that if she set her mind to something, that she would just make it happen. It was going to happen. And then supportive, she always cared deeply for those close to her. And I heard about her famous conversation starter of, come here, I need to talk to you about something. Maybe it was an infamous conversation starter of, uh-oh, what's she going to share with me? You need Jesus, right? That's what she's going to tell you. But no doubt about it, Deb was a credible woman and will be missed greatly by those who knew her. But I want to share a passage of scripture with everyone today. And it comes from Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 2. And it says, it is better to go to a house of mourning than to go to a house of feasting. For death is the destiny of everyone. The living should take this to heart. Now, I've always thought this is an interesting passage, that it's better to go to a house of mourning than to go to a house of feasting. And I don't know about you, but if I could choose which one to go to, I would choose the feast over the funeral every single day of the week. I'd rather go to a Thanksgiving meal with friends and family or a Christmas dinner where there's laughter and joy than to go to a funeral where we're coming together because of the sting of death, the loss of a loved one, a family member, or friend. While we would all choose, no doubt, the feast over the funeral, the scripture tells us that the house of mourning is better. And why is that? Why is the house of mourning better? Well, there's one word that came to mind as I was thinking about our time together, and it's this word, perspective. Perspective. You see, a house of mourning gives us a perspective on life that a house of feasting doesn't give. While there is joy and laughter and smiles at the feast, the house of mourning breeds something deeper and long-lasting. We begin to see life through a different lens, and this new perspective often comes through asking big, hard questions that the house of mourning makes us confront. And I want to wrestle with two of the big ones today, and this is the gift of the house of the mourning, house of mourning. And here's the first question that I think we should all wrestle with today is, what really is most important in life? You know, the house of mourning gives us this gift of asking this question, what really matters? At the end of the day, what really is most important? The loss of a loved one often gets us to evaluate priority. Is it my career? Is it making money? Is it doing all the activities under the sun? Or maybe it's something else. And the house of mourning reminds us that at the end of the day, those things, while they are good, there are much more important things in this life. Spending time with family and friends. Our faith. Living for a greater purpose. You know, the house of mourning reminds us that character is way more important than accomplishments. Psalm 90, chapter 90, verse 12 says this, teach us to realize the brevity of life, so that we may grow in wisdom. And the funeral, not the feast, teaches us to realize the brevity of life. And in so, we actually gain wisdom when we wrestle with those big questions. Here is the second big question that leads to new perspective that the house of mourning brings. And this is what it is what happens after I die? Now, I know, not a fun question to ask, but it's a really important one that the house of mourning makes us confront. You know, everyone is, you know, at the house of feasting, everyone is living in the moment and enjoying the good times, but funerals remind us of a truth that we often forget, that life is shorter than we think, and death is going to happen. Nobody knows the day or hour, but it is coming. It could happen today, it could happen tomorrow, or years from now. But the question is, what happens after we die? Kind of a scary question, but one that all of us, I believe, should wrestle with. Now, I know there are mixed opinions in the room. Some probably just go, I have no idea. Others would say, I don't think anything happens after we die. But here's the thing, one thing that I know about Deb, is that Deb had a different perspective than those two. One that I share with her as a pastor and a man of faith. Because of her faith in Christ, she believed with confidence and certainty of her faith that death was not the end of her story. While her physical body may have ceased to exist, her soul continues to live on into eternity with God in heaven. And I was told that Deb wasn't afraid of dying. And why is that? Why was there no fear in death? I mean, of course she wasn't seeking death. None of us seek death like that, but why was there no fear? It's because Deb believed, and I believe, that in Christ we do not have to fear death. Jesus said in John chapter 5, verse 24, he says, "Very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged but has crossed over from death to life." You know, it's troubling when we don't know what's going to happen after we die, but Jesus has taken the fear out of dying. When we put our hope in him, death is not the end. It's actually the beginning of an eternity in his amazing, beautiful, loving, grace-filled presence. And Jesus secured this promise when he died on the cross and conquered the grave by rising from the dead. And it's believed that he died the death that we deserve so that we wouldn't have that eternal death. And we can have this promise when we put our trust in him. And there's an interesting statement by the Apostle Paul in Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. And he said this statement, he said, "For to me, to live is Christ and to die is gain." Basically what he's saying is on planet Earth, my purpose as it exists is to bring glory to God and to live for him. But if I die, it's also a gain. It's also a win because I get to now spend an eternity in heaven where there's no more sorrow, no more cancer, no more sickness, no more brokenness, no more things that this side of eternity has to offer. And all of us in this room today must recognize that life is a gift. We didn't just make ourselves into living beings. We are here and it's a gift. And the fact that we have breath in our lungs today is a gift today as well. But the greatest gift is eternal life, life unending. You know, it's the hope of the eternal life that takes away the fear of death. And for the follower of Christ, it's been said that death is actually a comma, not a period. It's like just a quick pause for what's to come. And that means that Debbie's death is not the end of her story, but the beginning of an eternity with Christ. And for those that turn to him, that can be your story too. And that is why at Christian funerals in particular, it's not just bitterness. Now, there is bitterness at a funeral, right? I mean, for goodness sakes, I mean, we would all love to have more time with Debbie, no doubt about it, and that's a bitterness. But at a Christian funeral, it's bittersweet, bitter and sweet together, because we rejoice in the fact that Debbie continues to live on into eternity, into heaven, and that's what we choose to rejoice over. And so for my message, what I want to do is I want to encourage you to take the truth of Ecclesiastes to heart today. So I want to read it again. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 2. It says, "It's better to go to a house of mourning than to go to a house of feasting. For death is the destiny of everyone, and the living should take this to heart." So my question for us in the room today is, what new perspective will this day bring for us? Hearing stories about the way that Debbie lived her life and how her faith was so prominent and how she loved her family deeply, what perspective is that going to bring today? Or maybe a reminder of a perspective that maybe the busyness and the craziness of life we forgot about. Maybe it's a reprioritization of what truly is most important in life. Maybe that's the gift of the house of mourning today. And maybe for some of us it's to confront that really big scary question of what happens on the other side, the brevity of life. And based on what I know about Deb and her faith in Jesus, and the persistent evangelist that she was, according to her kiddos, always telling them about Jesus, is she would say, "Come here, I need to talk to you about something today." And then she would encourage you to place your hope and faith in Jesus Christ. You know, no doubt about it, Deb will be greatly missed by everyone in the room today and everybody who's watching online. She'll be deeply missed at the Pursuit Church for sure. But one thing we can do is we can celebrate her life today, and we can honor her legacy, and we can laugh together and we can cry together. But let's rejoice in the fact that we know where she is, and that brings us great hope today. So I want to invite you guys to stand, and we're going to have one final song that we'll sing together, and then I'll close us in prayer, and then we'll move to a time of fellowship and enjoying each other's presence here. But let's sing together.
Precious blood of Jesus Christ.
And that's the hope that Debbie had, because Jesus lives, she lives. And I think she would invite you to lean into him in this time, whatever you're feeling, whatever weight you're carrying, is there's this invitation that there's this God who loves you so much that he invites you to bring whatever it is to him and to talk to him and to let him be a source of strength and comfort in this season. But I just want to say I appreciate each and every one of you being here today to celebrate Debbie's life and to honor her. And I'm going to close with some prayer here in just a moment. And then afterwards, the family has, there's coffee and drinks and there's some food. We'd love for you to spend some time hanging out and just connecting with one another and spending time together. But appreciate you guys being here. Would you guys close with a word of prayer with me? Jesus, we thank you so much for the life and legacy of Deb. God, what an incredible woman that you created and used in so many lives. God, you worked through her in powerful ways, and you touched so many lives through her, Lord. There are people in this room who are recipients of just the incredible woman that she is, the way that she supported and comforted and called out and tough love and all those things. God, we thank you for her, and we just pray that today would be honoring of her, Lord, and that you'd be glorified through her life. And I also pray for the family and the friends that are mourning. God, would you meet them in the middle of that? Would you surround them with your love? God, would your spirit just be so near to them, God, that even though they're walking through trial and pain, that they would know that there's hope. And we thank you for this time to honor her life, and we ask that you would just move in power as the family continues to gather beyond this time. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, thank you guys for coming. You are dismissed. Please hang around and get some food and connect with one another. But thank you for coming today.